Could a 3,000-year-old invention keep us cool in modern times? The answer to that is yes. Ancient technology could play a huge role in our modern lives, if the researchers, engineers, and architects figure out a way to make this doable in all locations. Of course, we have to take microclimatic conditions into account, and it does rely on local weather, but it could possibly be that windcatchers may be the air conditioning of the future. My name is Kaylee, and today we're going to look into the ancient windcatchers of Yazd, a city in Iran with some unique Persian architecture. The nickname for the city of Yazd is the City of Windcatchers, but it's also well known for its underground channels transporting water called Qanats, its ice houses known as Yakhchãls, and its traditional reservoir storing water known as anbars. These are the features that made the inhabitants of this city survive the hot desert climate. On a yearly basis, there are only 23 days of precipitation, with a total of 49 millimeters, making this the driest major city in the entirety of Iran. In this particular climate, it's extremely important to keep yourself cool. Luckily, the Persians were masters in keeping their heads cool, it seems. The inventions of ancient windcatchers may have happened in ancient Egypt around 3100 BCE, during the early dynastic period. But Yazd is the city with possibly the most windcatchers in the world, as they were one of the biggest reasons this part of the Iranian plateau became inhabitable. It's a shame that many of the city's windcatchers have fallen out of use over time. But the city did draw scholars, engineers, and architects to it to possibly aid in our modern dilemma of air conditioning use and how that is affecting the climate. Because windcatchers don't need electricity to function, they could be incredibly important in areas where the electrical grid is unreliable and expensive. It would even make air conditioning available in places where there isn't even electricity. Windcatchers can look vastly different depending on their location and the climate. They can have one opening on one side without internal partitions when there is a prevailing wind direction. But in areas with variable wind directions, there may be openings on all sides with radial internal walls. This divides the windcatcher into vertical sections. These vertical sections may reduce the flow rate of the wind, but they do increase the efficiency at poor wind angles. If the wind hits the opening full on, it goes in. But if it hits the opening at a wrong angle, it can bounce off the corner and flow around the tower instead of going in. Areas with regular strong winds have small cross sections, while areas with hot winds have smaller shafts to cool the incoming. The wind towers with horizontal square cross sections are more efficient than round ones. Sharp angles make the flow less streamlined, which encourages flow separation. The tall wind towers catch the higher winds that blow stronger, are cooler, and are less dusty on average. Although, with some windcatchers, dust can be dumped at the bottom as the air slows down. With added mesh or plants, more dust can be filtered out if needed. In areas where the wind is dusty or polluted, or if there are insect-borne illnesses like malaria, for example, the air filtering may be a necessary part of the windcatcher system. Actual filters will reduce and disrupt the flow, unless it's harsh winds. Of course, there are ways to close the windcatcher off partially or completely. You can see that system right here. It's quite fascinating. Some windcatchers are octagonal, but their shape might be chosen for aesthetic purposes rather than efficiency. The shape of the tower, the layout of the house, how many openings the tower has, the internal blades and sections, the height, and the direction in which the tower is facing are all specifically adjusted to improve the windcatcher's ability to draw the wind down into the rooms of the building. Some buildings have a subterranean pool where the air flows over for further cooling, which I personally think is a smart option if you have the room for it. Now that we know what these windcatchers can look like, it's time to look into how they work. The short answer is that they don't have one particular function, but a whole array of functions. I will probably make a video in the future where I will take an in-depth look into all the different functions and workings of these windcatchers. But for this particular video, I like to keep it short and simple. To explain the workings in the simplest way possible, it goes like this. A windcatcher is never alone. It always is accompanied by another wind tower on the same building. The windcatcher catches the wind, which is then funneled down and will flow throughout the building. The cool air will flow underneath the warm air, and the pressure will push the warm air upwards. which then rises and flows throughout another wind tower, which in turn releases the warmed up air. Then there is the so cutely called night flushing. Now, I know that night flushing doesn't necessarily sound very cute. It sounds like you just woke up in the middle of the night, walked up to the toilet, took a pee, flushed, and, you know, you did your business. That's not this type of night flushing, thankfully. Night flushing means that the cool air outside will increase the ventilation inside as the cool air gets dragged inside, replacing the warm air and pushing the warm air out of the wind towers. In a windless environment, a wind catcher can function by using the stack effect, due to the differences in density from the air inside and outside. As the warm indoor air rises throughout the building and escapes through the wind tower, it reduces the pressure at the base of the building, drawing in cold air through open doors and windows. The stack effect is reversed during the cooler seasons, although a lot weaker because the temperature differences will be lower. And lastly, we will look into evaporative cooling, mostly used in hot and dry climates, for instance, like Yazd. With this type of cooling, there is a body of water near the air intake, where the air has to flow over the water before it reaches the inside of the building. Fountains in hot and dry climates are actually the opposite of fireplaces in cold and wet climates. Usually, wind catchers that are used for evaporative cooling are combined with a Qanat, an underground canal. This particular wind catcher will be facing the wind head on. They might be adjusted by opening or closing directional ports on the top. This draws the air inside. There will be a larger wind tower at the end of the directed flow that will pull the air out. This suction will make the wind travel through the Qanat, where it's cooled by coming in contact with the cold earth and cold water. The air is evaporatively cooled at the same time when some of the water evaporates when the hot and dry surface air flows over it. This humidifies the dry surface air before it flows through the building. It's then sucked into the building, where it decreases the temperature inside before it flows out through the large wind tower. Possibly the largest wind catcher in the world stands at the Dolat Abad Gardens in, you guessed it, Yazd. This is an eight-sided wind catcher with a height of nearly 33 meters. Wind catchers have been gaining some slight popularity in Western architecture over the years. Some of these modern wind catchers use sensor-controlled moving parts, and some use solar-powered fans to switch between ventilation and cooling systems. There are some unusual-looking ones that are being constructed in modern times, like the wind catchers at the University of Doha in Qatar, as you can see here. It may very well be possible that we can replace a huge percentage of modern air conditioning systems with wind catchers. It would not only be more environmentally friendly, but it would also be cheaper in the long run, and you don't need an electrical grid to rely on. If power were to suddenly go out, the buildings will keep being cooled by the ancient technology behind the wind catchers. Best part of this all, designing and constructing a wind catcher will cost approximately the same as our modern air conditioning systems, and after that would only need some easy regular maintenance. In the long run, it would definitely be a lot cheaper, so I would personally know which one I would choose. But then again, I live in a country where air conditioning is not really a thing for people at home. Before I end the video, I would like you to know that all the 3D renders that you've seen throughout this video and the amazing work behind it were created by the creator behind the Found and Explained channel here on YouTube. I want to thank him a lot for creating these renders for me to use. And if you'd like to see more of his work, I highly recommend checking out his channel Found and Explained here on YouTube. I've also put a link to his channel in the description down below, and his latest video is in the end card. But with that said, you've reached the end of this video. If you enjoyed watching, then don't forget to give it a thumbs up. Subscribe if you'd like to see more of these kind of videos, and click that bell icon if you want to be notified every single time I upload. If you haven't seen my previous videos yet, click the card in the upper right corner. I've put links in the description down below, and I always put videos in my end card. I'd also like to thank my patrons, Barry, Scott, James, Floyd, Vaughn, Rox, ProboDC, and NGC6543. And I would like to thank my channel members, Naversky, Yellowhammer, Henry Hewitt, Stephen Jenny, John Jiff, Barry, and Ben Oppenheimer. Thank you all so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one. Bye! beach with wall. Good enough, right? I could put a dinosaur here. I could put a pyramid here.